Okay, so a very good afternoon in India and a very good evening wherever we are in the world. My name is Chirajoy. I'm a professor at IIT Jodhpur, and I'm privileged to chair this session at JNM 2020. So in this session is on short papers on content analysis. So we have the first paper addressing the cold start problem in output recommendation using visual preferences from Dhruv Verma, Kshitij Gulati, and Rajat Shah. Dhruv will be presenting the paper. Dhruv, over to
Yes,
you.
sir. Hello, good afternoon, everyone. I am Dhruv, an undergraduate student at IIIT Delhi, and will be presenting our paper titled Addressing the Cold Start Problem in Outfit Recommendation Using Visual Preference Modeling. Today, e-commerce for fashion is booming, but consumers still face issues while selecting outfits that are appropriate in context and suit their liking. Various different approaches have been adopted to personalize outfit recommendation. However, most of these fail to address the cold start problem. Addressing this problem is not only relevant to new users, but also for users who prefer to experience the recommendation service in guest mode, or simply without getting profiled. Now, taking a closer look at the cold start problem, the cold start problem is a challenge which is faced by most recommendation systems, where the conditions are not yet optimal for the system to provide the best results. This means that whenever a new user uses any recommender system, the system does not have adequate preference information about this new user to give him or her the best experience. On the contrary, for a pre-existing user, the system has learned the user's preferences over time and can now provide him with the optimal recommendations. As you can see in the illustration over the slide, the first case A is an old user, which has preference information already captured by the system. And thus, the user is pretty much happy with the experience he's getting out of the recommendation service. On the contrary, the B states a new user, where the preference information might be missing, and the recommendation system does not know what the user might actually like or might actually want to wear. So in this case, the user might end up getting frustrated with the system. Now, coming on to the methodology, fashion knowledge, now we talk about the data set first. Fashion knowledge can be best represented in terms of person, occasion, and clothing, as prescribed by the literature. Presently, various fashion data sets like Deep Fashion, Polyvore, Fashion VC, etc. have been collected. However, none of these have a representation for the user's context as well as occasion. So we curate our own fashion data set with a total of 2893 diverse images for each occasion from social media platforms like Pinterest and Instagram, using the popular keywords and hashtags in the image and the slide. These images have natural backgrounds and outfits that represent real world people wearing the real world dresses in the world. After curating this data set, we manually filtered out irrelevant images and noisy data. For example, selfies and blur images, etc. Only images that best represent the fashion knowledge are kept. About the annotation, it is done by two fashion experts. A third annotator, which is also an expert, is used for tie breaking in a majority voting scheme. We also calculate the inter-annotator agreement between these fashion experts using Cohen-Scapa statistics, which is 0.81 for categories and 0.68 for attributes. Like from the literature, it seems that these values seem reasonable for a good annotation scheme. Coming on to the categories and attributes. So here is a representation of the categories and attributes we selected to best represent the fashion knowledge. Each category defines a particular region of clothing. Example, t-shirt is for upper body and athletic pants may be for lower body. And each attribute further characterizes a particular category in terms of the specifics like color, sleeve length, upper body length, lower body length, neckline, enclosure. And within these, sleeve length, neckline might be representative of the upper body categories like t-shirt, and lower body length might be a characteristic of the lower body categories like athletic pants. In total, there are 20 categories and 39 attributes across 7 occasions. So the 7 occasions being travel, sports, wedding, date, party, prom, and office. Now, coming on to the working and the implementation of the system, the input to our system is gender, some images representing the user's personal fashion taste and occasion. Let's take travel as an example. Now, coming on to the visual preference modeling leverages these input images we collected in the input phase to extract fashion knowledge based on the visual features. For the same, we use a faster RCNN for identifying the clothing regions in each images first. After extracting these clothing regions, we feed these regions to a multitask classifier, MobileNet V2 in our case, to characterize each outfits in terms of clothing categories and attributes similar to our dataset annotation. This way, we generate a semantic representation of each outfit. In the related work, various approaches for extracting fashion categories and attributes have been proposed. For example, there has been a lot of use of brand CNNs, buyer STMs, etc. However, most of these work fail to incorporate the correlation and dependencies between the categories and attributes. Hence, we make use of the multitask learning approach due to its great information sharing capabilities between the different tasks. So in our case, different classification heads in the multitask classifier are responsible for optimizing the category and different attribute prediction tasks. So here are some illustrations of the fashion knowledge extracted by the proposed visual preference modeling approach. The outfits are represented by different clothing categories and fine-grained attributes, as you can see in the following images. Now, we've extracted this fashion knowledge from these input images, but how do we incorporate this extracted knowledge into outfit recommendation and thereby personalizing it? Our approach generating personalized recommendation follow a two-step process. First, we start by applying a simple content-based filter using the gender and occasion on our recommendation data set. This results in a smaller and a more relevant pool of outfits. Within this filtered pool, the outfits represent different high-level fashion concepts like style, patterns, seasons, etc. Different categories and attributes which we extracted are contributing towards building these high-level concepts. For example, if we take an example of the season part, short sleeves clothing may represent summer and t-shirts may also represent summer, while long sleeve clothing and categories like sweater, blazer might reflect winter. On the other front, if you talk about style, then categories like blazers, suits, skirts are more likely to fall in the formal attire category. And if you talk about chinos, sweaters, t-shirts, they are more likely to fall into the casual wear category. Therefore, we take an unsupervised approach, namely weighted KFK modes, to organize these images into these concept clusters. Here is an illustration of the concept clusters I just talked about. So you can see there are also centroids of these clusters. We use the semantic representation of these centroids as the representation of a particular cluster. Once we have the generated semantic representation of the input images, as we extracted from the visual preference modeling step and the concept cluster from the previous step, in the second step, we compute a weighted similarity between these clusters, these semantic representations. So a higher weight is assigned to a cluster having maximum similarity with the input images, thus resulting in a higher chance of recommendation. This way, we optimize the recommendation for a diversity and personalization. Coming on to the evaluation part. In the first part, we show a comparative analysis of the accuracies and the F1 score across different classifier architectures and in different configurations like single versus multitask mode. We use ResNet 18, ResNet 50, and MobileNet V2 for in both the single task as well as multitask configurations. And to our observation, MobileNet V2 with a multitask configuration outperforms the rest in both category as well as attribute prediction tasks. In attribute prediction tasks, the MobileNet accuracy is the highest, being 89%. And in the clothing category prediction task, the highest accuracy is MobileNet V2 again with 74%. In the second part of our evaluation, we compared our results with the existing state-of-the-art models for clothing category and attribute prediction. To our observation, The proposed approach outperformed the state of the art in average attribute prediction accuracy and performed comparably to the other state of the art, which is Fashion KE from Ma et al., a paper from NUS in this particular case. So our accuracy for category prediction was 73.5%, whereas for Fashion KE it was 74%, and for attribute we jumped significantly from 70% to 89%. Coming on to evaluation of the quality of recommendations made by our system, we conducted a pilot study with participants for the same. The pilot study was required, in the pilot study, the participants were required to rate the recommendations on parameters like relevance and diversity on a 10-point Likert scale. The participants were shown two sets of recommendations, one with their preference modeling and one without, in random order so as to avoid any ordering effect. We also made sure that the participants were not aware whether the recommendations were inclusive of their preferences or not, to eliminate any bias while evaluating. Now, coming on to the results of the pilot study, the results of the pilot study suggest that users rated the recommendations highly in terms of diversity. As you can see in the bar chart, even in without preference and with preference, the diversity score are pretty high. This affirms the success of the weighted clustering approach. We found that on an average, the users found recommendations with visual preference modeling more relevant as opposed to recommendations without it. Also, an important observation is the slight reduction in the diversity score with visual preference modeling. This could be attributed to the increased importance given to the fashion concept clusters, which were more similar to the user outfit images, leading to a more number of outfits from the same cluster overall, which reduces the diversity. Overall, the pilot study suggested that we were able to optimize the outfit recommendation in terms of diversity as well as relevance and address the cold start problem with our approach. Coming on to the conclusion, we attempted to address the cold start problem for new users in an occasion-oriented outfit recommendation. The proposal performs state of the art in attribute prediction and compares really well with the category prediction. The results of the pilot study also affirm that the recommendations in visual preference modeling are more relevant and fairly diverse. Interesting observation which I just pointed out was the slight reduction in the diversity score with visual preference modeling, probably indicating towards a potential trade-off between the diversity in results and personalization relevance. Coming on to the limitations and the future work, for a more robust evaluation, we plan to conduct a more extensive study with a larger participant group. This time it was only 10 participants. Personalization is also significantly dependent on the quality of images provided by user, since we are taking a small amount of images from the user. So the system is highly dependent on that images. Therefore, instilling certain high level fashion concepts like body shape, texture, weather, seasonal variation, and also the cultural dependence of certain clothing styles could really help improve the personalization. Additionally, the use of multimodal information has shown promising results in the past literature. We speculate that using multimodal information in our case may contribute significantly towards improving performance. Since our dataset is usually derived from the social media platform, there are other kinds of media available over there. Here are the references for the slides. And I would like to thank my co-authors for a great working experience and all of you for being a great audience. Do refer to our paper for more details, and do not hesitate reaching out if you have any other questions. So are there any questions?
Thank you, Dhruv, for the nice. Any question from the audience?
Attendees can ask their question in the chat.
Okay. Hope I have a question.
Yeah, please.
So since the title is this code, cold start problem. Can you briefly explain how that particular problem been addressed? Because the experiments are in this, how you get the difference between the record not there in the database for a particular user. So how that problem is addressed in your work paper?
Okay.
That is the title of the paper.
Yeah, sure. So basically, the approach we are adopting is, like, for example, there are platforms, online social media, online shopping platforms, where the user might not be wanted to be profiled and want to use the system and the recommendation system in a guest mode. That is kind of a cold start scenario in a real world. So in this particular case, we might take little information from the user as 5 to 10 images, which might represent his or her personal fashion taste. It's not necessary for him to give his or her own images, but also, like, he or she can give any kind of fashion images which he or she might love. It might be from some model or someone, and then we basically extract, like, the elements of fashion and the fashion knowledge from that particular those set of images, as well as the gender information, and then we optimize the fashion recommendation on the based of the fashion knowledge extracted from a small input given from the user. So that is the approach we adopted.
Thank you. Any other questions? Right, so let's move on to the next speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dhruv, for your nice presentation.
Thank you.
So the next presentation we have from Abhijit.
Yeah.
So the title of the paper is Steady Flow Approximation Using Capsule Net. Neural network.
Yep.
This paper is from Vijay Kutapoti and Sathar and Kikur.
Yes.
So, Abhijit, the screen is yours.
Okay. Let me know when you can see my screen.
Yes, it is visible now. It's good.
Yeah, 1 second. Okay. So, yeah, I'll start. So I'm Abhijit Kurtkoti. So the topic of the paper is steady flow approximation using capsule neural networks. So the agenda for the presentation is we'll go through the problem description and the related work where they have worked on this domain, and why we are using capsule neural networks, and the proposed methodology and the architecture that we have used. Also, the how we have obtained the data set and how we have pre-processed that, and we'll discuss about the results and followed by conclusion and future work. So coming to the problem description, so before going to the problem description, I would like to give a quick overview of CFD, that stands for computational fluid dynamics, where we simulate the physical interactions of fluids such as liquids and gases with the surfaces. So this will be achieved by solving the governing equations, that is Navier-Stokes equations, and the CFD solvers solve them iteratively. So these are actually very time-consuming, computationally expensive processes. So they require a huge time for producing the simulations. So for preliminary design explorations, like if a designer wants to explore some design alternatives, he has to wait for for simpler designs it might take some hours, for and some complex design problems it might take days or weeks. So due to this constraint, he might not be able to have enough simulations in his hand for to make a preliminary design decision. So we thought of implementing a approximation model. So, which is not as accurate as, highly accurate as CFD simulations, but it's a real-time prediction of those simulations. So we can, the designer can have, have a real-time simulations, so he can have the preliminary design decisions make faster. So Also, these simulation, I mean, approximation models cannot replace CFD simulators as they are actually needed for the final validation and the overall CFD problems. So this is just to address the preliminary design simulation, so the designers can have much higher productivity and reduce the time involved in the preliminary design decision. So we are trying to we are using the capsule neural networks, that is again a data-driven surrogate model that is for the approximation of steady flow. So there have been many successful implementations using CNN. Like as for any image-based problem, we use CNNs, and there have been many variations of those. For example, the first one here uses the CNN for steady flow approximation using shared encoding and separated decoding. And also the second one uses gated unit based architecture, which is also based on CNN. And they are using for fluid simulations in porous media. And the third one is similar to the first one. That is, they are almost doing the same thing, but they are, the architecture is different, that they are using UNET with multiple decoders. So the problem, I mean, the most common thing between these works is that they have used CNN, but they have also used MaxPool, which is a common thing every state of the art implementation of the CNN uses. So all those CNNs are have achieved the state of the art performance, like they need a huge amount of data for training. So for our problem, for CFD simulations, we can't really have that much data for training, as the simulation itself takes around days and weeks. So we need to have a model that takes lesser amount of data for training, but at the same time performs well. So that's why we thought of going with capsule neural networks instead of going with CNN. So CNN with max pooling has two major drawbacks. One is max pool results in significant data loss. And also CNNs with max pool don't really associate the hierarchical relationship between the lower level features and the higher level features. For example, if you want to detect a phase for a CNN, CNN only takes the collection of the lower level features, such as like for to detect the face, it takes the collection of lower level features such as eyes, ears, and nose. But the orientation of those things and how they are placed doesn't matter for CNN with MaxPool. But Capsule addressed this issue by having the instantiation parameters, and Capsule is the kind of activation function which takes vector input and gives out a vector output. These vector contains instantiation parameters where they address the pose relationship between the features. So in this way, they are able to establish the hierarchical relationship between the lower level and higher level features. And also capsule neural networks use translational equivariance rather than translational invariance. Translation invariance is something where CNN with MaxPool, which is attained by MaxPool, where it will be immune to the shifts in the image. But translation equivariance is something where the object moves, the probability of the detection remains the same, but the instantiation parameters change. In that way, the vector changes its direction, but the length of the vector remains the same. That way, we know that we can say that the feature is still there, but the orientation has been changed. So due to these features, capsule neural network is able to utilize lesser data than CNN to produce the same similar performance. So concepts in relation to capsules. To optimize the capsule, we use dynamic routing algorithm. Works on the principle of vector dot product. So when there are when the lower level capsule wants to send its signal to the higher level capsule, the scalar weight between those two capsules will be increased if their vectors are similarly oriented. So in the case of vector dot product, if two vectors are in the same direction, the dot product would be higher. So this concept on that principle. works on that principle, and we use this another special squash activation function, which is a nonlinear vector to vector activation function that takes the capsule as the, that is, vector as input, and converts the length of the vector in the range of 0 to 1. So coming to our proposed architecture, our architecture is similar to the one which was originally implemented for MNIST, but the difference is we are not just really trying to construct the image given the image. We are trying to predict the velocity field given the input as the boundary. That is, the object is the input, and we predict the velocity field that is in the for steady flow as the output. So we have used this architecture to evaluate the performance, capsule neural network architecture for the problem at the hand. So all the related works that I have discussed have used unsupervised approach for efficient reconstruction, but we are using supervised approach, especially for the encoder part, to make use of the classification loss function, which really helps us to classify the boundary with higher probability. So as far as any reconstruction model, our model also contains encoder and decoder. But the special part is encoder is a supervised encoder, which can encode the input into a 16-dimensional vector. And if the data has n class, so we have n 16-dimensional such vectors. So encoder part is constructed using convolutional layers and capsules. So we are not using MaxPool, but we are using capsules. Decoder maps the encoded feature vector to reconstruct the image into a velocity field. This is constructed using fully connected layers. So for optimizing the convolutional layers and fully connected layers, we are using Adam optimizer. And for optimizing the capsules, we are using dynamic routing algorithm. And this is the architecture we are trying with which we are implementing the model. So this is the boundary. So this is actually obtained, that this is just a 2D boundary, and this is the flow prediction. So this is the primary caps layer, and I'll discuss both in detail. So as far as the encoder part, the image that will be given will be the boundary. So convolution layer will apply the ReLU activation function after the convolutions. So that uses 256 kernels of size 9 and 9x9 on the input image. And the primary caps layer has 32 capsules, each of which applies 8 9x9 into 256 kernels to input the input it receives. The outputs will be converted to the vectors of dimension 8, and from this we'll map to the final encoder part, that is the 16 dimensional encoded vector that we were talking about. So the 8 dimensional vector will be transformed to 16 dimensional vector to effectively include all the instantiation parameters. And decoder is constructed out of fully connected layers, and decoder tries to reconstruct the original velocity field using the encoded class vector. That is, the if, for example, if the the input boundary belongs to the class 1, it will decode it using the encoded class vector 1, and if the boundary belongs to the class 4, it will do it with the encoded class vector 4. So as I said, we will be using the classification loss function. This is very important as it's used for predicting the class variables, classification vector with high probability. What it's trying to do essentially is the m plus here states it's a constant 0.9, both are same. So if the model wants to predict the correct level, the first part will be 1, and if we are trying to predict the incorrect level, it will, the second part will be 1. So since it is 9, we can say that the loss will be zero if we are trying to predict the class with probability higher than 0.9. And similarly, the loss will be zero if we will be trying to predict the class with the probability lesser than 0.1. So for reconstruction, the LR stands for reconstruction loss, which is essentially L2 loss. So we'll be providing the velocity field calculated by LBM CFD solver instead of the boundary network. We are using LBM solver as the velocity field predicted by simulated by LBM solver as the true velocity field, and the predicted velocity field is the one we are trying to do. We are trying to predict. So the total loss is the combination of this. So the training data is
need to speed up a little.
So the training data was obtained by LBM CFD solver. So we really wanted to test the data with lesser data as possible. So we just tested it on 28 images. 28 training images were there, and we had 7 test images. So further part is, by definition, velocity field inside and on the boundary is zero. So we mask out the pixels inside and on the boundary of the object. So we'll be considering the flow domain as the region around the boundary. So also the velocity field predicted by CFD solver and our velocity fields will be similar, like in the around the boundary, not as the whole image. So results, as we can see, the velocity, the image quality of velocity field has been improving with each epoch. And there are totally 7 test images. So this is the results. So boundary of the object is the first column. The velocity field predicted is the second column. The third column is the one which was simulated by LBM. So these are the second. And this is the reconstruction loss, the progression of the reconstruction loss at different epochs. We can see that it has been decreasing at the each epoch. So the results obtained were like, we got the reconstruction loss of, total loss of 3.92 for 28 training images for CAPSnet. And we compared this with the CNN model with MaxPool with a similar architecture. We got the reconstruction loss of 4.89. for 300 images, 300 training images. So in conclusion, we can say that CAPSnet requires a fraction of the data that is required by the CNN to produce similar or better results. Like, we were able to get the results that we wanted with the capsule neural network. So this really makes suitable for steady flow approximation problems. Like, this is a small scale implementation, but we go for higher scale implementation, still it will be helpful. So future scope and limitations. So since we used only 28 images, we were able to classify all of them. But for large scale projects, we would be requiring at least 1,000 images, 1,000 to 2,000 images, and manually classifying them is a bit tedious task. And also, it's not really possible to classify each and every boundary in specific class, because there might be some overlap between the classes. And also, we can use both translational equivariance and invariance, and we can have better results leveraging the benefits of both. Yeah, and the references, and thank you. So thank you for being present. Any questions?
Thank you, Abhijit. Question, audience, those who are attending can pose their questions in the chat window. Abhijit, I have a question regarding this capsule model that you say.
Okay.
And it has been shown that yes, capsule has an advantage over the standard human. But have you tried this variation in training samples? Right? You have said like 28 samples
Sorry, sir, I didn't hear you properly.
What I was asking is
yeah.
the number of training samples.
Yeah.
So now, as you have said already, that the number is very low in terms of
yeah, yeah.
what we
yeah.
usually see in a deep learning model.
Yes, yes, yes.
But,
that's
yeah. So yeah. Have you studied the how it's overfitting or whatever? Have you studied
yeah, yeah.
that part? Like,
yeah, that's why we use the capsule. Like it's it has, as I said, it uses translational equivariance rather than invariance. So that's why it has the knowledge of the orientation of the object as a whole, not just like for CNN. It takes a combination of the lower features. As I said, if you want to detect a whole object, it identifies it as the collection of the lower level features, not as the they don't really incorporate the spatial relationship between them. Let's say if I want to detect a face, capsule assumes that the eyes should be at the top and the nose should be below the eyes and the mouth should be below the nose. So we have this relative positioning in capsule that will be addressed by instantiation parameters. So for a CNN, like if you provide an image wherever the eyes are, like if it's in the place of mouth, doesn't matter for the CNN. And even if the mouth is too large than the face, it doesn't matter for the CNN. It just takes that combination of those features and tries to predict. That's why when we are trying to train, if there are some different orientation of the images, the loss would be higher still. But for the capsule, since it has addressed all these issues, we'll be requiring a lesser amount of data. And yes, we'll be as far as the implementation goes, like all the related works that I've discussed have used around 500 to 600 images. So 300 images was the one which I tried to solve with. So I really wanted to make sure how well this model works for the fraction of the data. So here we have used only 28 images. This is just a small scale implementation. But if you go for the large scale implementation, like say for maybe for complex design problems, maybe in porous media, or here we are trying to predict the velocity field. But if you want to predict the pressure field and all that, and also this is steady laminar flow. And if you want to make some turbulent flow prediction, we still, the data would be in higher scale. Like maybe, I don't know, like maybe the function of maybe some exponential, it will grow as an exponential function. For that, if we have some model which requires lesser data, so we'll be having the enough accuracy to come up with steady approximation models. Because the implementations that I've known are like, they are not really, let's say in large scale implementation, or we can really say a continuity model. So to go in that direction, we really need a lesser amount of data. So here I have used 28, but for large scale model, we could like limit that data capacity and benefit from that. Hope I answered.
Thank you. Any other question? Sir. Okay then, thank you, Abhijit. Nice presentation. Thank you very much. Let's move to the next speaker. So we have the third paper, Assessing Risk of Attack in large network systems with context-sensitive probabilistic modeling. And Rahul Madan, Kanish Rana, and Arun Balaji. So presenter will be Kanish Rana. So Kanish, the screen is.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I, Kanish Rana, would be presenting from Triple IT Delhi, would be presenting a paper, Assessing Risk of Attacks in Large Network System Using Context-Sensitive Probabilistic Modeling. So let's start with the motivation behind our work. So recent large-scale attacks like Mirai botnet, Gen attacks, etc. Have brought to the forefront the importance of cyber defense against cybersecurity attacks being carried out against critical systems. One of the famous examples being the NHS being hit by the ransomware, rendering the healthcare system in the UK in shambles. The intent of these attacks are now not only limited to monetary benefits, sometimes not, they are even sponsored by state as well. And computing capabilities have gone through the roof, and therefore even computational capability is not an issue anymore. So to tackle this, we need to implement, there needs to be a robust implementation of intrusion detection system, IDS, in a setting of a large network system, keeping in mind the different kind of attacks like botnet, DDoS, and DoS. There have been some related works in this field. Hawken et al. Proposed an outlier detection method using neural replicator network. So the main idea behind this work was that they want to identify the problem with the data itself with fraud detection grouped as an outlier. Saurav et al. On the other hand, proposed a temporal-based model based on RML for time series anomaly detection to address the challenges posed by sudden or regular changes in normal behavior, which they termed as drift in healthy behavior in their work. Malhotra et al. Proposed a method of using stacked LSTM architecture by training a network on a non-anomalous data and then using it as a predictor over several times. However, there are some areas that were not considered in the related work. First, different types of attacks have not been considered at a point. That is, different types of attacks like DDoS, .NET, they have not been considered. The other thing is, they have not utilized the usage of low-level network-level information that is typically collected in many data center networks to understand more about the characteristics of data. To address these areas of concern, we address these issues by using data sets that have network information, and they comprise of different type of attacks commonly carried out against a large network system. Moving forward, there are a few terms and notions that are fundamental to our work, and we need to clear it right now. So there is a notion of states in our work. So the state of the system refers to the value of the network features and how they could indicate whether the system is under an attack or not. For the now, the next term was risk. So how do we identify risk? So the notion of risk that we present is that the risk of an attack in a study refers to the data flow that precedes or is a part of an attack lodged against the large network infrastructure. And a policy is devised to avoid the system from undergoing the attack. So what's the policy? So the policy used is devised by using MDP after assessing every possible state for the network that could be in, and then advise the system on which states to avoid. With this, when you combine risk and states, so there's a notion of risky states, which is basically the risk is identified with the state by calculating using a proposed method that is based on the importance of a network feature, and which is different for different type of attacks. This is what we talked about when we wanted to say that different type of attacks have not been considered at a final game. And the weight assignment policy in an MDP is according to the data provided. So the methodology that is followed in this work, we start with the data collection in a data set. We'll talk about the data set in a bit. Then on that data set, there would be a construction of states from it. So the process of construction of states starts with the ML modeling, which would consist of feature selection, bidding, and clustering. These three would then be fed once the states are constructed. The state would be detected using LSTM. The belief from the LSTM would be passed on to the MDP. So a state space is given to an MDP, which identifies and assesses the risk by the definition that we give it, and then devise use an optimal policy. And using that policy, a breach could be avoided. So let's move on to talk about the data. So the data set used for this project has been generated at the University of Brunswick under the name of CIC, Intruder Detection System IDS 2018 on AWS. How is it generated? So user profiles were generated to represent events and behavior as seen on a network. So, and these events were captured into a network using tools of one of the applications.
the vulnerable application, and there was a tool called NetFlow Detector, version 8. So we use that to collect the network. And what comes out of it? So the final data set comprises of different type of attack scenarios, namely botnet, brute force, DDoS, DOS, hardened, infiltration from the inside, and web attacks on the system. And after combining all these profiles, every data set has 80 features generated from the network traffic. So now that we have our data set, we want to construct states out of it, the notion that we presented. So first, we actually need to perform feature selection algorithm, feature selection. So we are processing data set that have more than 300,000 entries and 80 different features. And this would warrant the number of features to be reduced. So since we cannot process the data with so many features, therefore, we need to deal with the subset of it. On top of it, since we are dealing with the tag, there is class imbalance. And that's been treated by using a bagging existing method called exegesis. The sampling technique, as suggested in other words like oversampling or undersampling, is avoided to maintain the natural network flow that was being captured at the source. Then comes binning. Why do we want to bin ourselves, bin the value? So we need to limit ourselves to the construction of finite state spaces to avoid the problem of state space exclusion. The sheer size of the data set make recursive binning algorithms like class attribute interdependence maximization, the K method, and the class attribute contingency coefficient, CACC method, infeasible for this setup. So we have used supervised binning using decision tree. Even after binning, if we move forward, let's say every feature has n distinct values and across 10 features, so that would be n into n. So that's still a large state space. So we need to have an even smaller state space for running dynamic programming algorithms using policy generation. And we employ clustering techniques to reduce the space size and obtain the abstract representation of the state. And we have used clustering-based abstraction techniques because other techniques like the ASR irrelevance abstraction and the PyCell irrelevance abstraction and the QCell irrelevance abstraction, they assume the model, including the estimation of the significance of the state. Therefore, to not introduce any bias, it is fairly appropriate to use a fair algorithm for clustering. That's why we are just using a simple algorithm, the K-means clustering, for our cluster. Now, after we are done with this, so we have clustered our values and we have constructed states. Then we use LSTM to detect the states. So with the use of LSTM, we need to keep the time series in, dependency of the network intact, and therefore we use LSTM. It is used to detect the cluster number, which in case is the state of the system. And the belief from the LSTM is passed to the MDP for generating optimal policy to avoid a breach in the system. Formulation. So when we set up the LSTM architecture, there are a few issues that we need to address. The first issue is the addressing the issue of initial size of the contextual input that we want to create. So to address this issue, the LSTM architecture is used to process entries with initial batch of size 100, 250, 500, 1000, and 1500 entries. And we then check how it predicts the system state. And by analyzing the accuracy loss, we select a we decide that at least a batch of size 100 is needed to start, which can be further reduced since the context has already been established. After we are done with the LSTM and we have detected a cluster number with the LSTM, we feed this information to the MDP. MDP or the Markov decision processes is used to accurately incorporate user behavior. And through this set of features, we define the MDP set state space. And we have already discussed how we need to have a finite set of state space to avoid the state space exclusion problem. And we have developed a reward, we need to develop a reward risk mechanism based on the definition of the risk system that we discussed. And then we select appropriate actions to identify the risky states as future sensors by learning an optimal policy. So we need, for an MDP, we need to form it's a tuple, so basically four element tuple. So we need to have a finite set of states, finite set of actions, a transition matrix, and a reward matrix. So after detecting these states, actions are fairly simple. We have kept it simple to differ the mapping complexity between contextual features and these actions. So basically, a direct and straightforward method that we have used is that the actions are just two actions. If we remain in a state, we denote it by zero. And if we jump to another state, we denote it by one. And there's a weight assignment algorithm that we have used. So basically, weight has been assigned for every feature on how important it is to classify the current state as risky or not. Now, coming to the mathematical equations used for MDP tuple construction, the reward function. So the reward function RSA, is a reward function for going from state S by performing an action A, is defined as WARA plus summation over WIFI. The term WARA defines the effect of performing a certain action on state A, current state A, RA, and RA is the reward, and WA is the weight for it. The summation in the equation is a risk matrix. So the risk matrix in where WI are the weights given to each of the features that we have selected in the feature selection step, and how they contribute to determine the risk of a state. The reward function. So to determine if the risk, we are done with the reward function. Then comes the risk threshold. For the risk threshold, we need to determine if the current state is risky or not, and a risk threshold is calculated. The average reward for each of the abstracted states is basically, since we have employed clustering, we want to average it out for the state of site A, state, and that's the average reward. And the transition function that we have followed is basically is used to generate the probability of reaching a state SK by performing an action of A in a state SM. Moving on the illustration, so basically experimental configurations that were followed in this research. So the choice of algorithm for optimal policy. It is based on the time taken to evaluate the optimal policy and also the algorithm's accuracy. And the reason for choosing clustering algorithms. As discussed, we employed the clustering-based algorithms, which K-means algorithms, and they are based on the accuracy obtained from the MVP in which the discount factor was A. The discount factor has a range from 0 to 1 and it was varied from 0.1 to 0.9 and 0.01 to 0.1. And this discount factor was used in conjunction with the clustering algorithm, where K means perform pattern. Then comes the reason and impact for choosing discount factor to MDP. So the discount factor choice was based on the fact that the value needs to be kept near 0 as it indicates that the agent need not to look far ahead into the future, but the value could not be kept too small as a model will then lose its predictive capability. The optimal value of the discount factor after experience was found to be 3.3. And there's also an aspect while using LSTM layers. So what was the best activation function? We found that the hyperbolic tangent function, so the correct estimation of the state and system of the is the goal. So that's the hyper that's how we found the activation function to be the best. This figure shows the performance of the various policy that we algorithm and there's a comparison between the policy iteration, the value iteration, the relative value iteration, and the modified policy iteration. And the modified policy iteration outperforms every other policy in terms of type taken, although they have similar accuracy. As in the previous slide, the Tanish function performs better in terms of accuracy when compared to the other available activation. Now the result from the data set. So the data set that we use was split in the ratio 50% for training, 20% for validation, 20% for testing tested approach. And these were the results. We obtained a pretty high recall value and precision value. Although on some data sets, the SM score was not that good. So we wanted to test it out and benchmark it against the proposed model with the other existing model in the same data set. The best result that was obtained in other studies has a precision of 0.996 and a recall of 1 and an FL score of 0.998. So there have been just a marginal increase, but there have been some, there is an increase, but there's a computation cost that as well that we have used. We have used the same MDP. So that's a major point. Third, we have tested a model on another data set to test the hypothesis of using an MDP in conjunction with an LSTM. And this was tested on an intelligent decryption CICI DC 27 dataset. The best state of the art result for the DDoS and DDoS attack using machine learning are a model outperforms them on an F1 score at 0.01 and precision by 0.05. Again, this was in conjunction with the abstracted suit, we get an accuracy of 99.62%, and on a large state space, we get 90.66%, which will work. So basically, a very interesting fact that comes out of MPP is a discount factor and its implication on the forward looking policy. So we could explore that in the future as well. And since we have this probabilistic idea of using MPP in a IDS setting, so we can extend this idea. We'll be trying to extend this idea to other data set and situation, and that's not available in the POM PP and Bitcoin and Spirit. Thank you for having me. Q&A.
Thank you, Kanish, for this nice presentation. Questions, please? Panelists, anyone from the attendees can ask questions by typing in the chat window. Okay, Kanish, I have a question regarding this application areas that a particular work may have. In terms of you're talking about policies and all, no? So can you give us some specific examples where particular work can be applied real world?
Can you type it out, because I'm not able to hear the question well.
I'm asking where can you give some specific real world examples where is work that you have presented as a direct application.
So yeah, so basically the data set that we used, so basically they were trying to simulate a setting in which a company they set up a bunch of 480 company tools. So basically they wanted to set up a company, and they were carrying out attacks against these basically, we use the data set for the same fact that this is a scenario where basically any type of attack, so basically since they tried out every type of attack, even the infiltration from the inside and the web SQL attack in every attack. So we use a data set that was fairly mimics, not on a that scale, let's say on a very large scale, but on a very good medium scale. So this policy generation, basically, when we have a policy, once we encounter that an agent is encountering risky states over and over again and at a high percentage, we could know that an incremental attack like a DDoS attack, which takes place at a incremental pace, it doesn't happen at once. So once we get a risky state and a risky state in a setting space, we would know that, okay, there's a risk that being that a system systems or system is being exposed to. So a work could be in that setting where, let's say, a small firm is facing an attack, so it could be used in that setting.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Kanish. Is there any other question? This is the last paper for this session. So if no more question, then as part of the organizing committee and as a chair of this session, I want to thank all the presenters who have presented very nicely, and the papers are very informative, and the title of the session suggests like content analysis. They have really presented various ways of analyzing the content in the data, whether it's an image or other type of data and various applications. Thank you very much all the participants, attendees, all the panelists joining us for this session. With this, we conclude the session, and I request all of you to join us for the subsequent session and the rest of the conference. We have one more day of conference. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Chirunjoy.